ಎಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ನಮಸ್ಕಾರಗಳು. ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ವಿಜ್ಞಾನ ಮತ್ತು ತಂತ್ರಜ್ಞಾನ ಅಕಾಡೆಮಿ ಕಡೆಯಿಂದ ಈ ಸಭೆಗೆ ಎಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ಸ್ವಾಗತ. ಗುಡ್ ಮಾರ್ನಿಂಗ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಗ್ರೀಟಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ಟು ಎವ್ರಿ ಒನ್ ಹಿಯರ್. ವೆಲ್ಕಮ್ ಟು ದಿಸ್ ಸ್ಪೆಷಲ್ ವೆಬಿನಾರ್ ಸೀರೀಸ್ ಆನ್ ಹಾರ್ಟಿಕಲ್ಚರ್ ಆರ್ಗನೈಸ್ ಬೈ ದಿ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ಸೈನ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಟೆಕ್ನಾಲಜಿ ಅಕಾಡೆಮಿ ಬ್ಯಾಂಗ್ಳೂರ್ ಇನ್ ಕೊಲಾಬರೇಷನ್ ವಿತ್ ದಿ ವಿಜ್ಞಾನ ಪ್ರಸಾರ್ ನ್ಯೂಡೆಲ್ಲಿ, ಯೂನಿವರ್ಸಿಟಿ ಆಫ್ ಹಾರ್ಟಿಕಲ್ಚರ್ ಸೈನ್ಸಸ್ ಬಾಗಲ್ಕೋಟ್ and the Indian Institute of Horticultural Research, Bangalore. We have the esteemed speaker this morning, Dr. Arthur Santosh Attavar, the Chairman and Managing Director of the Indo-American Hybrids, Bangalore. If I may be permitted, son of the legendary Manohar Attavar. You and now Dr. Santosh Attavar. Good morning and welcome to you, Dr. Attavar. So we are also having amidst us.
Thank you very much.
The team members of this of this entire event.
Sir, your voice is breaking, the network issue, it seems.
Sir, video tag the body, sir.
Your voice is breaking due to low bandwidth, it seems. If you can turn it, video turn off mode there, it will be much better, sir.
Anand Umesh sir, no,
we talked last month. First of all, you a warm welcome. This is one of the events of the horticulture event Karnataka, being organized to commemorate the International Year of Fruits and Vegetables, and this event has been titled as Fruits and Vegetables for Health and Nutrition, comprising three events. One, a conference scheduled in November, to be specific, 7th-8th November 2021, 7th-8th-9th November, a series of talks in the webinars, four talks, 20th of every month, started in July, and today we are on the August 20th, and two more talks coming up on 20th of September and 20th of October. And today, as I said, we have the esteemed speaker talking about seeds and planting material, vegetables and fruits, for health and nutrition. With this brief welcome, I request Dr. S.B. Dandin, former Vice Chancellor of the University of Horticulture and Sciences, Bagalkot, to kindly chair this session, introduce the speaker, and conduct the proceedings. Dr. Dandin, please.
Thank you very much, sir. Good morning to everybody. I once again heartily welcome all the participants for today's second speaking speech in the series, which is being delivered by an eminent plant and seed supplier of the world, none other than Dr. Arthur Santosh Attavar, who now heads as the chairman and managing director of the Indo-American Hybrid Seeds. Indo-American Hybrid Seeds is known world over for its quality planting and seed material. So when I joined my BSc first year in botany, my teacher asked one question, whether seed is first or plant is first. But immediately I told plant is first. And I told, hey, without the seed, where plant comes from? So it was boggling my mind. And when I happened to read the Indo-American Hybrid Company, they have given an answer, both seed and plant are first because they are producing both and supplying to the people. It is the best answer, perhaps. So coming to Dr. Arthur Santosh Attavar, who is a well-qualified personality in the field of seed and planting material, had his basic degree in science from Mata University in USA, and he had undergone a training there. And later, he has widely traveled for different countries to understand the subject, to understand the trade, to understand the need. Because all the things, three are to go together, to be a successful entrepreneur and also a successful businessman in this new subject of plant and seed trading, which is now facing three major issues: the eroding biodiversity of very important plants, the rules and regulation of the trade international, and also the quality aspect. This company, namely the Indo-American Hybrid, has successfully mitigated all the three issues, and now they have become the world leader in supplying the quality planting material. Dr. Manmohan Atawar is also a vice president of the International Seed Federation, ISF, and he is also the chair of ISF and of the task force created by that company. He is a member of the African Seed Trade Association and also a member of the Variety Release Committee of PPVFRA, which is one of the initiatives taken by the Government of India to recognize the farmers' varieties and also give them the issue of benefit sharing. Now, Dr. Atawar is actively involved in the development of horticultural science with respect to the most important issue, supply of planting material, which has been time and again referred as one of the bottleneck for the development of the industry. For everything, seed comes first. Seed means it's a planting material also, and they are here everywhere. And he is also promoting young students by giving scholarships, by giving projects to the agriculture universities, so that he also recognized the importance of the trade and a trained manpower in this issue. Recently, I had I witnessed a talk in America. In all over the world, we have our software engineers, hardware engineers. We have so many other people. But when come to the agriculture and horticulture experts, our presence, unlike the country like Israel and one or two, our representation as a technical manpower is not that visible. So probably in this direction, Indo-American Hybrid Seed Company is also developing a lot of the youngsters in various to address various issues of plant and seed material in ornamental vegetables and fruits. And they are doing excellent service. We hope his Dr. Atawar's leadership, Indo-Arabica Hybrid, will achieve many more laurels and milestones in the years to come. And now, with this brief introduction, I request Dr. Atawar to give his talk on the seed and planting material importance in addressing the issues of health and nutrition through vegetables and fruits. With this, I welcome all of you once again, and I thank the authorities for giving this opportunity, and I request Dr. Atawar to take over the mic and start his speech. Dr. Atawar, please.
With the permission of the chair, Dr. Dandin, yes, Sahab, I'd like to thank the chairman, Dr. Dandin, for this introduction. And also, I'd like to welcome our members of the KSTA, Dr. Ambekar Eknath and Dr. Mulimani, and others who are with us. And with this, I thank the chairman and request Dr. Atawar, please.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
So thank you very much, Dr. Dandin. First of all, I'd like to thank Dr. Ayyappan and the KSTA for giving me and our organization to be a part of this initiative. And I'm very glad to be here today. And my presentation will mainly talk about seed planting material, seed quality. But what I realized is this is a very vast subject, and there's a lot of interconnections between the seed and where the journey of the seed and till it reaches the end user. So what I've done is I've taken snippets from different aspects which I feel are very critical in seed quality and quality planting material. So as I get started, you'll see that we are going across a varied sort of landscape to put into perspective of how to go about this process and what are the main factors that are today very relevant after the, you know, post or the during the COVID situation. Thank you very much. Just slide share. Okay, the role of vegetable seed and planting material in health and nutritional security. That's the topic I was given. And as I started getting deeper into this topic, I realized that it's very, a very detailed. That it's a very detailed subject, and there are a lot of factors that are contributing towards this. Just a moment, please. Okay. Let me start with the message recently by our Honorable Prime Minister when he spoke to our Olympians, and this is what he said. You can see for yourself. I don't want to read out the slides. So this is for me a sort of starting point when the highest authority and the leader of the country brings about this sort of awareness on malnutrition and on nutrition in general and the diet pattern. Today, this is the introductory slide. Today, if you look at worldwide in the United Nations and among a lot of discussions that are being had on food, we are talking more about dietary diversity. That means you're putting more vegetables on your plate, more fruit and vegetables on your plate, and so on, so that your food is more nutritious than just filling your hunger. Because the biggest concern we have is the malnutrition and hungry people. For example, you can see for yourself the numbers here. Although the hungry people, we seem to be addressing the issue every year, but it has been growing consistently since 2014, and it's a concern for the world. And it's a concern for India, because even we have over a sixth, this says over a sixth of India is permanently hungry or undernourished. So those are big numbers. Now, to overcome this situation, it's not going to be possible by one institute, one company, one organization. It has to be a collective effort of all the institutions, of all the citizens who are involved in this, to collectively move and put the country forward and bring down this sort of, bring down these numbers over a period of time. This is just some more numbers from the Global Hunger Index. And for your information, I'll be sharing this whole presentation with the organizers along with the sources. So that will be of help if in case some of you want to go through this. Right now, India is ranked 94th out of 107 countries with a score of 27.2, which puts us in the serious category of the global hunger. So we need to really start acting on it. Maybe we are producing a lot of carbohydrates. We are doing a lot of wheat, paddy, and we are doing other more carb and starch type of foods. But what we need is more of the fruit and vegetable component to be in the plate, so to speak. Anemia has come down by 3% from 2000 till 2015. And one of the concerns here again in this slide is, you know, women, especially pregnant women, are still having a lot of anemia. So how do we address this? And it's a concern, because this is where the education has to happen, regardless of literacy levels. It has to happen at the root level, and this information, dissemination of information that we all have, needs to trickle right down to the village level, so that there is an awareness of what is nutrition, what is important nutrition, and how we can address malnutrition. Although I do not have answers for this, but what I'm putting forward in the next few slides is slowly how we can all achieve these goals and fall in line with the call that has been given to us by the Prime Minister and the government. The government can only do so much, but it's actually we, the people who have really stepped forward, the great scientists of this country, all the machinery, both government and private, to come together, and then we might be able to address this and bring down the numbers. Although the under five mortality rates have come down, it's still a cause of concern that there are still 35,000 mortality rates in the live birth rates. If you look at it, it's 5%, 35% under five, sorry. Most children with malnutrition live in Africa and Asia, and you can look at the different aspects further to the two slides ago, what I showed you all, and how these numbers, how they pan out. Now, this is an interesting slide because the per capita gross availability of vegetables in India, it says 388 as per this source. But the current average consumption of vegetables is about 120 to 140 grams. Okay, in some places you can add another 100 grams where they might be, you know, consuming roots and tubers. But as far as vegetables go, these are the numbers we have. So here again, the suggested number is about 400 grams per person per day, but we can definitely work on getting this better, getting these numbers better. This is just a quick slide to show you what a healthy plate should look like. This is from the ICMR. Now, changing trends of vegetable production across the globe. Here again, Asia has really grown quite a bit in the last few years. So has the world. So vegetable production is going up. And it has to go up, especially in India. We need to get into that 300, 400 grams per day of vegetables, as well as address the malnutrition issues, which can again be addressed through nutrition. And vegetable is one of the pathways along with the other proteins and fats, etc. So here's a slide, I'm just giving a snapshot of more efforts needed in indigenous nutrient-rich vegetables. So I'd like to take a few minutes here because what we mean by nutrient-rich vegetables are more of our indigenous vegetables that maybe our grandparents used to consume more, our parents also consumed, but we today and our children are not consuming them as much. So here, there has to be a lot of grassroots level effort in terms of understanding the nutritional qualities, and we need to do a little deeper dive and understand what are these nutrient-rich vegetables that are found across India, across the 15 agroclimatic zones, and in some cases, the sub-agroclimatic zones as well. One of the good efforts that while researching for this, me and my team found was that recently, again on the 15th of August, the Tamil Nadu has taken the initiative of declaring 5 districts of Tamil Nadu as a Moringa export zone, which is a very good thing because more of Indian vegetables and indigenous vegetables have to cross the 7 seas, so to speak. We've seen a lot of South American influence in what we eat today. We are eating the potato, we are eating tomatoes and sweet peppers and hot peppers. Well, that's all fine, but you know, what efforts are we making as a nation to promote more of our highly nutritious foods, among which Moringa has got a lot of good publicity and popularity, and maybe the curry leaf. And then similarly, there are many amaranthus, there are hundreds and hundreds of Indian vegetables, which if we all can put our minds together and work on them, I'm sure in the next 10 years, we'll have a list of new and emerging vegetables from India that can go across the world, thereby spreading our quality food to the world and also empowering our farmers to produce for overseas market, as well as our seed producing facilities can produce for export. Indian leafy vegetables, Indian vegetables, So this is what we should be looking at as a country, and especially since agriculture is a state subject, the state should take the initiative to develop the products that are native and popular and nutritious in the state. Here's a slide showing some of the nutrient qualities. I believe this was done, these vegetables are consumed across India, but this study was in particular about the northeastern part of India. But many of these vegetables are being consumed across India in different states. And here's another interesting slide. You know, we talk about nutrition security. So this is a very interesting slide which shows the whole cycle of an integrated breeding program for often leafy vegetables, Gynodropsis gynandra. And this is just to give an idea of how we can also develop our greens that we grow, maybe around North Karnataka, a lot of different greens are consumed, how to grow them. And that's where the seed production system will start falling into place. First is the how you purify the lines, and I'm not talking only about hybrids or open pollinated. I'm just talking about how to improve the crop side by side, study the nutrition, and then make it available. See, the block that's going to come is due to non-availability of necessary quality food, and that's where your security is important. What sort of informal or formal system do we have? That is very critical. And that is going to drive this. And here's another slide, just talking more about what I just said. It's more on the nutrition. Everybody knows this. This is common knowledge, you know, and some of the basically we are native of the West Coast, and the West Coast has a lot of the Malabar spinach, a lot of amaranthus, a lot of local gourds, which we consume. And I don't seem to see them as plentifully available in Bangalore. So that should change. Our mainstream vegetables will always be there, but what about our own indigenous vegetables? When are they going to get shelf space? Okay, palak is available, sometimes methi is available, but we need to have more of those vegetables. There are hundreds and thousands probably across India, but which are the ones that can be produced easily, which can be, you know, scaled up, because scalability over a period of time is very essential for this. So here we come to more on the production side of things. So let's look at quality seed. This is something we've all learned and we've read about and everybody knows about it. So the seed is basically, once again, if you look at it in a different angle, it's the delivery system. So if you're a breeder or a farmer or a company or a public institute, you've got some fantastic varieties that you want to, you know, scale up, you want to be produced. So first of all, you produce your nucleus seed, and that seed, if it's handled well and it can be scaled up to a commercial level in terms of quantity, quality, and availability, that is important. So it becomes the delivery system for what we are discussing today. That is the nutrition aspect, the nutritional security. Because they say there's unity in diversity. So there should be unity in diversity even for nutritious vegetables of India. I think the era now, I take a minute here to talk about what happened post-corona virus, and it's still there, but it's still current, I guess, it's not post. But what we are seeing is there's a big kind of global alignment back towards nature. And we've seen it happening in India, we have seen it happening in the US, in many countries, where due to the ample time on hand, we are able to connect with nature. Whether we are growing a flower, whether we are growing a small vegetable patch at home, or whether you're doing something on your balcony. And this is, according to me, a very strong signal that ultimately we are very closely connected with the earth. And this is the reason why, once again, we should utilize this time period to really bring to the forefront. And that's what I really liked about this challenging topic, is to, you know, throw the challenge and say, yeah, this is what we have on hand. And we are seeing that youngsters are very, very responsive. They want to come and buy seeds from our garden center. They want to buy seeds online. And they are showing that enthusiasm, and we should nurture it so that 24 months, 36 months from now, we have a different kind of an environment and awareness about our own vegetables and also our own indigenous vegetables as such. So one of the, see, timely availability of good quality seeds on season. So it needs a lot of planning. We have to be very structured if you want to get into a seed production system. You got to look at the ideal agroclimatic zone where you're going to produce, the soil types, etc. Then you got to see the producibility of the, sometimes the vegetables are very shy yielders. So we got to tackle that challenge and maybe come up with a better variety which is having better yield. So there are multiple challenges like that. And then also, if you're going to get into seed certification also, this is the same procedure. The process may vary a little bit, but all the procedures, the fundamentals of seed production is, the science is very much needed. And the last para here, food security is closely associated with seed security. And here again, we are talking about, you know, Atmanirbhar or self-reliant India. So we'll have to really introspect as a nation and as individual of how we can achieve this. How can we get dietary diversity on the plates of every Indian? Of every Indian who's today not able to access. See, one of the fundamental problems again in seed availability is one thing, and the access. Some farmers may want to grow, but they don't have access. They don't have access to information, and they don't have access to the seed. So that also can change. And I was thinking, we have a wonderful KVK model, which we need to further strengthen. The extension has to be strengthened, not on paper, but functionally. It has to be stepped up. Maybe it's working well, it needs to work better. If we want to roll this out, at the beginning of our discussion, we spoke about the action plan, right? I mean, we need an action plan for what we're thinking about. And believe me, after being 55, 56 years, after this company has been through so many cycles, we strongly feel that it's possible. We can work on seed systems. We can work with very difficult crops, and we can try different agroclimatic zones and make this a reality. Similarly, there are many other companies who are great companies who can also work in their respective states or across India. But this is definitely a possibility. It's just that we are caught up in producing a lot of the commonly consumed vegetables. So maybe we need to step back and you know, take a view, a review, and probably create a renaissance of sort, a rebirth of the indigenous crops of India. And that would be a very, very essential and a wonderful thing for this country. And it can, we can showcase to the world what sort of diversity we have in agriculture, in horticulture. It's more about, you know, the characteristics of quality seed. I don't want to read through this. It's just a, you know, you can just look at the bold sentences, the bullet points, the in bold for the physical attributes, seed vigor. What's happening of late is due to maybe production issues, climate change, we are observing a lot of issues with first count, that is seed vigor. So we observe within our own company, as well as from many of the companies we are testing for in our ISTA lab, that first count is always a challenge of late. And the first count on a towel will tell you that, okay, this lot is going to do very well, because the first count, when it's high, the establishment in the nursery is high. And when the establishment in the nursery is high, the crop establishment is very good in the farmer's field. Now, that's another aspect. The consumption of seed is coming down and the quality parameters are going up. Maybe back in the 70s, they were taking, you know, 120 grams of tomato. Then it came down to 60. Today, there are farmers across India in many places, they use only 20 grams. That's due to two reasons. One is the expectation and the understanding of quality awareness has really crept in. And secondly, they give it to nurseries who produce the seed and give it to them. So they are only buying the seedling. So when you're buying a seedling, you're buying 1,000 seedlings and you want all good seedlings. So that's where the vigor and the health of the seedling is very important. Of course, the other common aspects are physical purity, genetic purity, moisture content, and all of these are very important. Moisture also is very tricky. Although it doesn't, it's something that can really destroy a seed lot if you're not careful in your testing and storage methods. Just a shot of our quality lab, our ISTA certified lab in Bangalore, where a lot of this work is happening. Some shots of just to show you beet seed vigor. I'm sure everyone must be tired of seeing tomatoes all the time, so we just wanted to add a few different slides with. This is beet seed. We do a lot of beetroot open pollinated production, and we are doing it in a very cool area in India, and we've had a lot of success by constantly improving the quality, and today it's one of the best selling beet seed, and we are proud that we were able to develop it, improve it through our R&D efforts, and make it available as well. This is seed vigor in sunflower, just so you can see the healthy seedling and what's you know, how it's comprised of and what it's comprised of and how it looks. Now, coming to the, again, seed production systems, there's a lot of discussions going on seed production systems and the stability that is required and the scalability and the transfer of knowledge. And this is, again, possible. I think in India itself, we have so many agroclimatic zones and production is a possibility. Now, recently, the government of India also wanted to lay more emphasis in producing everything in India. A lot of crops can be produced in India without a doubt, but we need to have the infrastructure in place. Capacity development has to be done. Capacity building has to be done. Both have to be done. So we need to start working on it now. We can benchmark with the best countries in the world that have currently the best systems. And we can, you know, benchmark, we can look at where we are today and start setting the parameters required here. Having said that, and being a, you know, today it's a global playing field. So there are companies producing in India for markets outside India and vice versa. There are Indian companies also producing abroad for seed to get into India. So this is inevitable and this will continue, but it doesn't mean that we should stop looking at our own country. There's a high potential, there's a lot of arable land, there's a lot of land available for seed production. And now that's where the policy is very important to make it a conducive environment for young entrepreneurs, young scientists getting out there so that they are able to achieve this. To achieve and understand, they can cross-train across in other countries for 6 months. And this is possible. In fact, we trained a lot of young students who are today producing seed in different parts of the world in the 80s and in the 90s. And you know, they trained. Where did they train? They trained in India. They trained in Rani Banu. And they are all in very, very, very top positions. Because if you learn the fundamentals, then you understand what is the requirement to produce quality seed. And rest of the points are very common. You know, you look at nursery management, which is now the more and more nursery management is itself differentiating into a separate industry, and we are finding more people investing. There are all sorts of nurseries. There are very basic nurseries. There are those that are semi-automated, but going forward, it might get automated, and it's going to become more a high scale. It's going to become a scalable business, and farmers are looking for high quality seed, so they don't want to grow it in their own farm anymore. Although a big portion of them, a big part of them are still doing that, but they would like to reduce that burden of 30 days. You know, 0 to 30 days, they don't want to do anything. Like I said earlier, They want to finish seedling and they want to plant it. And so seed producers, they have to be very careful about the quality of seed they give. And then raising seedlings, it's a whole different ball game. It's a big industry today because there are so many enhancements that can be given to the seed. There are biological treatments that are being brought out. There are many environmental friendly treatments that can be made. There are so many ways of handling the seed. We call it the 0 to 30 days in our company, and that is very important. And we are focusing more, and we are finding out, you know, you might think, hey, what's there in that? You know, your vigor, your seedling establishment. No, that 0 to 30 days, the quality of every seed matters, because ultimately, as we've been taught, every seed is a unit. It's a unit of life. So when you start looking at it from that angle, then you understand why today many companies are selling in seed count. And you might think it's expensive. In some cases, they are expensive. But if you look at the return on investment for a grower in terms of the seed cost, it's the percentage, usually good seed cost, 5 to 7% of the total input cost. That's what data we have seen. There may be some other variations on that by other observations and other companies. So this is more of the more common aspects, you know. And this is that's a very basic slide, agroclimatic regions, everyone knows, but this is where this can decipher the code of all these products, all the crops that are native, and we can start studying more in detail about them, the nutritious vegetables of India, and how we can, you know, start developing them and look at the agroclimatic zones. And there are some zones that are better for seed production than others. So we'll have to develop systems, production systems for amaranthus, which has in some cases a lot of dormancy. It has to be treated differently. For beetroot production or kohlrabi production, which needs a little more vernalization and chilling, the requirements are different. So we'll have to study that, which are the crops. Once we identify, we'll have to study the zones that we are going to look at, and then take it forward. This is just a basic seed production system chart that we've put up. There are different types of crops, you know, high volume, low value, high volume, then high value, and there are, you know, different aspects. You can, it's a self-explanatory. And in terms of vegetables, what's happening is there's a lot of in-house production that many companies have started moving towards green net house production, because we have seen a distinct difference between open field and net house production, because the plant is lesser under stress, it's better managed. And as a result, less stress, better seed, and as a result, the end product is very good. Okay, let me go to the next. So here are some, this is some automated nurseries that are overseas. So you can see what a nursery should be looking like as India continues to grow and there are more people to feed. This needs to be set right. And for this to look this way, your seed has to look good. Your seed has to be good, not only look good. It has to have some quality. It has to have the uniformity so that the farmer is getting good planting material. And that is a must. That's where it all starts. You can't, you know, informal systems sometimes tend to just like the old system, you produce something, you bag it, and you sell it. And I mean, it's like they say in the, you know, in English, it's a luck of the draw. If you are lucky, you get good seed. If the informal system sometimes don't pay attention to moisture or don't pay attention to pests and diseases, the farmer ends up being the recipient of this sort of seed. So it's important that the seed quality is good. Here's an operation with the grafted tomato that I saw in Tunisia. This was set up by the Dutch, but you can see the importance of the, you know, the hygiene and the quality. This is being in a rock wool, the way it's being grown, and a very impressive operation. And you can take a look at, again, once again, how it's all very clean, laid out. It's very sterile environment. You can't go in there with your regular shoes. You'll have to wear your, you know, clothing, and everything has to be in order. This is NetHouse facility that is in around Ranibanur area. So, you know, things have changed. Farmers have adapted a lot to these systems, and they are improving. And you can see this is how a field should look when you transplant crops. They should be uniform, and this is under mulch. And now one good news for sustainability is that a lot of the mulch systems are now biodegradable, and I highly would like to see that more and more such efforts are taken, and the government should get involved. Because see, you produce the mulch, and then if the mulch is not biodegradable, it's a big problem. Who's going to take care of the disposal? So this is something that you know, I was told more and more of biodegradable mulches are available. Okay, initially the technology cost might be high, but it also, there is an obligation that we should not be, you know, dirtying the environment, and the recyclability is definitely a very important part of this whole sustainable exercise. Here's another tomato production facility, very clean. And you can see the quality, the leaf quality, the nutrition is very good, the spacing, and the weed mat underneath, which protects the weeds from coming, which can, you know, so often it's overlooked. Even we ourselves, you know, make that mistake, even after all these years, where we, if we are not paying attention, the weeds can, you know, harbor vectors, and those vectors can really create a lot of problems for us. This is an open field tomato production of one of our newer hybrids in the field. And what we found over a period of time is even here, you can't have a standard spacing. For example, when you produce, the spacing varies based on the plant type. Okay, it makes it very difficult for the production manager, but unless he's paying attention, he might end up with so much of high density planting with, again, diseases creeping in, vectors coming in. So everything has to have a system, everything has to be studied, and then only you can get your production, seed production system in place. Here's a very clean cucumber production field, again in North Karnataka. Open field production of squash. This is, of course, for export, but we just thought we'll, you know, add this slide in just to give you an idea of what are all possible. What are the possibilities? And here's a very nice shot of a melon production. You can see how each melon is individually wrapped and given the support. And just like human beings, even plants, once the stress is reduced or non-existent, we find directly the seed quality, the weight of the seed, everything goes up. You shouldn't have weeds, you shouldn't have too much of water stress, the right fertilizers, and then you get a very good crop. And of course, it has to be in the right season. Recently, of course, we've had some challenges with the, you know, parental lines, being the safety of parental lines and security of our parental lines. So our production head has, you know, worked on pollen farms very much in our own state. In North Karnataka, where we are, you know, producing our own pollen, we are collecting. We are, it's a very, very precise operation, because you can't mix up the pollen and then get into trouble later. So it's all color coded and numbered, and we harvest the pollen, and then we have a separate crew for harvesting them. Everything is segregated, and then we store them. Sometimes we produce in a good season and even store it for another year. One season at least minimum, and in future the idea is to use preservation for longer period, especially in case of you know, male parents that are pollen shy, so that we can produce more pollen, and then the farmers have one less thing to worry about. They just have to grow the female, grow it right, We don't have to worry about planting the male, harvesting it, and extracting pollen. And this has been very successful. We were told that we won't succeed because others had failed, but we decided because they had failed, we are going to try and understand why they failed, and that threw some answers, and we've been able to streamline the process very well. And in fact, now all our new hybrids, we no longer give the male to the farmers because there's a lot of temptation and there's a lot of people looking out for these males. And once your scientist has worked 7 years almost to bring out a hybrid, and if your lines get nicked and out into the market, then there's no coming back, because the IP protection is still something that is happening very well. There are a lot of registrations happening, but the enforcement of someone who's taking another person's intellectual property or another organization's property and taking commercial benefit out of it, I still feel it can get a lot better. And that's a challenge today for individuals, for companies, for public institutes who are releasing some really path-breaking varieties and hybrids. And now, I mean, all of this will happen only with the proper skill development and training, and we have been constantly at it. Every year there is a program going on. We explain a lot of new technologies and new methods to our farmers so that they can understand how things are going, and we have like a classroom approach, and then we follow it up, and then also we measure it by the quality of the seed that those farmers are producing. So this is just a cold storage facility, which is common nowadays. It's just, and we also have a biotechnology lab, which is helping us to cut down the grow out test time by streamlining the DNA, markers, so that sometimes when we have to release the seed quickly for export or for domestic market, we have bands that are established by them, and then they can give us the result so that we can clear it for sale or clear it for export. Otherwise, we have to wait for 3 months, 4 months, which is a very long wait and also takes a lot of time. And sometimes, like one of the last year or year before, we had a heavy rain and washout, so the whole crop was gone. But not all of them respond the same way. Some crops do better, some hybrids do better, some OPs can be checked better, some cannot. Also, seed health testing, I think, is very important and becoming more and more important as part of the supply chain, where all the lots have to go through testing, and thereby once again ensuring good quality seed and good seed security. And this is just a recap of the breeding and seed research. Aims to develop better yielding, disease resistant, nutritionally rich vegetables, and the seed improvement aspect, and the seed production and supply systems, which I spoke about. So the seed sector shares the common unifying goal of providing quality seed for farmers around the world. And we've also been involved with the UN and FAO. I'm on FAO task force for seed systems, and how improving seed systems is one of the focus areas. And also during seed sector shares the common goal, and as I was saying, efforts to make sure that you have to make sure that the supply systems are there to ensure farmers or households sustained ability to have sufficient quality of the desired types of seed at the right time. Because there's a lot of talk, seed systems, they are a very critical component, coming back to the UN and FAO, and our Indian scenario, that seed system is very, very critical to enable the availability of seed. And I'm not saying it should be just with the public institutes, private companies. It can be across anyone. The thing is empowerment. What is the fundamental, the vision of KSTA? That empowerment, transfer of knowledge has to happen. It can be at a, see, they say think global, act local, you know. So locally we have to act on it. These seed systems are very integral part, and wherever there is there are seed systems that need to be improved, even local growers, even a farmer, he should have that ability to understand what is isolation, how he can improve his own seed. It could be his own variety. We have many farmers registering at PPVFRA, many of them. So they also have a right to know how can they produce the best quality of rice or vegetables or leafy vegetables, so that they understand what it is. And this is where the empowerment comes. And this has to be a very, very key component if we have to reduce the dependency and be self-reliant as a country. We have to pay attention to this. For our, especially I'm talking about native species, native vegetables, farmer saved crops, where the farmer is himself, you know, this all started, the whole seed hundreds of years ago started with farmers selecting better quality. Look at maize, you look at any crop. So naturally the farmers have selected through the years. And today the technology is much better, where they can do even better. And then they are able to register it, and then they have the IP, and similarly the companies and the institutes and individual innovators, they'll all be benefited. And also we spoke about tissue culture. So we don't do much on food crops right now, but we have done tissue culture banana in the past, and we've done also, you know, elaichi. And today we are still focusing mainly on ornamental plants. But as Dr. Dandin said earlier, we are willing to see if there are possibilities in helping the forestry, you know, of trees, helping there. Seed conditioning, I feel there are a lot of options today. As I mentioned, there are several seed improvement methods, and this is gaining a lot of space, and a lot of discussions are happening around the world for this. And I think here as well in India, there are many companies involved in, you know, improving the value addition of seed. For example, seed pelleting to make it easier to plant by precision planting, or even by manual planting. When you have a pelleted seed, it's much easier to handle it, provided that pelleted seed has that intrinsic quality of good emergence and good first count and establishment. And then there are physical treatments, numerous treatments that are available. And there are also advanced seed treatments. But just to keep it simple, we'll have to see what works for us as a company, or as, you know, as an individual. What works for us is what we need to go for. Like that, there are numerous technologies, but what is important for us is what we need to focus on. And once again, I'm re-emphasizing, if anyone has any questions, even after this talk, they can write to me and I can put you on to our relevant supply chain or R&D personnel if you have questions on any of these aspects. And they'll definitely be much better place to answer it. So a little more about the seed. India has emerged as a major seed hub in Asia, and many leading firms have invested in breeding and production activities across the country and overseas. And even in the public sector, you know, starting from NSE in the late 50s and 60s, there are many numerous institutions. So the idea here is that everyone works collectively to achieve something great for the good of the country, and to reduce the, you know, problems associated with hunger and malnutrition. Ultimately, all that we spoke about will lead there. And this is a snapshot of Indian seed industry, and you can look at the product mixes, and you can, I don't know if it's very clear, but this is generally what are the common crops. But other than this, what I've based my talk on specifically was more of the nutritious vegetables that are going to contribute towards nutritional security. And if we have seed security, that's going to be the ultimate thing for us. The Indian scenario of production of horticulture crops, if you look at 91-92, I think it has really gone up, and the production has increased, and equitable consumption is what really has to go up, so that more and more people have access to good food and they are aware of what it's good for, so that along with their starch requirement, they also have these other fruits, vegetables to consume. So this is just last few slides on the way forward. So once again, it's the famed PPP model to be worked together, and we would be glad to be a part of that. And we have some ideas that we could share. Some of them might work. And it's important that we recognize the good nutrition is a priority for nation and global health, equity, and economic security. I think that's a very important sentence in this slide. And also investment in research for undertaking research in climate change, abiotic, biotic stress, and biotechnology is already happening. So along with this, the more of indigenous vegetable research and vegetable research in non-mainstream crops is, I think, also very, very important. Then vegetable intake and nutritious food intake, regardless of the literacy factors across India, the 1.38 billion people, I guess everyone should at least be made aware of the good quality of food or the nutritional aspect of food, thereby making, we should make that accessible, and the information also should be accessible, as I said earlier. And that can start making grassroots level changes, if not today, tomorrow, if not tomorrow, a few years from now, but definitely it will. And this is more extension of the same topics that I mentioned earlier. Already the government has the Poshan Abhiyan program, and we are also wanting to contact them and see how we can participate in that with regard to the nutrition aspect through vegetables, since we have that little bit of knowledge in that. Then integrated management of emerging diseases and pests also is important, because more and more IPM methods have to be rolled out, because that again comes in the, it affects the health part. So we have to be very aware of it. And I think even now the awareness of chemicals is also increasing. So people have to judicious use, and also you can have integrated IPM as the core, and then judicious use, so that the plant, when it's harvested, the crop when it's harvested, is residue free. And this again will play a key role in India exporting to many countries without fear of rejection, thereby again doubling or increasing our exports, which the Prime Minister has emphasized. We need to increase exports. And right now, if you look at the composition of agricultural exports in the last year, the agriculture exports, the plant, the seed, vegetable, fresh produce exports are still not much. The seed exports, yes, is very good. It's around 1,000 crores, 900,000 crores, which is excellent. But imagine if India starts exporting quality vegetables to different parts of the world. And also, keep in mind that with this, we should also feed our hungry people, keep our malnutrition people with malnutrition nourished, so that the next generation onwards, the change is evident, and we have healthier humans coming in, and you know, they will be working much better with good food. They will be able to think, they will be able to create much better. And some of the policies that we were able to find is the National Nutrition Policy in 93. And then the, as I mentioned, the Poshan Abhiyan also, we are trying to understand it more and more. So we've spoken enough about making it available and accessible and being safe. So things like on-farm productivity through extension and awareness is very important. Reduction of post-harvest losses has to happen. It has to happen because that will again make more food available. And that includes, you know, the post-harvest losses due to logistics issues, no cold chain in place. And I believe this is another focus area for the government is logistics. They're really working hard on developing better logistics, better systems. So we need to, you know, I think that has to happen soon so that the post-harvest losses are reduced, and also the storage conditions will have to improve. And wherever we have vegetables that can be stored, it's better to store it so that it's always available. Then, of course, market access, there's a lot of awareness even in market access now, and you know, we'll have to see how things pan out. There's a lot of discussion happening, direct market access to the farmer, or a better remuneration. You know, the government is working on it, so let's hope that we are able to overcome that issue. One is market access and price to the grower. Then this is more of the, you know, what I said on the nutrition, but home gardens and rural vegetable consumption by growing in the rural area and peri-urban areas. I think I remember Dr. Atawar, our chairman, and my dad, who many years ago, I think in the mid-90s, they were already discussing peri-urban development. And today that's a reality. If you come to our farm on Saturday and Sunday, the amount of people that are there, okay, plants also are helping well-being. Along with that, they are buying a lot of vegetable seed, herb seed, and growing it. And even if they get a few plants, they are very happy. And this is an awareness that will, I feel, will continue to build over the next few years. And even many, we have seen many individuals who have farms and farmhouses today are going back to those farms. They are planting a variety of mangoes, they are planting a variety of amla, and this is really good because they are also planting bear and lot of indigenous fruits and vegetables, and that is a good sign because at least they are growing it there, and by doing that they will have a better closeness and understanding of nature. So just a slide on biofortification. We are also looking at it from the research point and see to see what, where we can contribute in this. Of course, we are working on beans and we are working on several other crops, but not on sweet potato and stuff like that, but definitely pumpkins and cucumbers and all we are already working on. Yes, this shows a good slide of, you know, one of the best lines we have in the white cucumber. You can, white bitter gourd, you can see how, you know, prolific it is. And this is the seed production. This is coriander production in Maharashtra, the crop production. So even a coriander, if you grow it right and do it right, this is how it can be grown. So just I wanted to give you, you know, improved production systems are also happening in India. And these will give way to increasing productivity of the nation over a period of time. And here are some of our programs on, you know, improvement. We have several programs. They are all small programs where we take a few crops and start working on them. This is the famous Ujjalokia from northeastern part where we are bringing more uniformity. but still retaining the high heat. And these are some of the crops, nutritious vegetables. Some are indigenous, some are exotic, but we are working on these. Some we are already marketing and selling. And you know, there was a misconception many years ago that hybrid seed companies should just focus on hybrids, and we believe that that's no longer true. And luckily we have persisted with all our open pollinated lines, although we were tempted to not continue, but we somehow, due to our passion, we kept going. And today many farmers across India are using these products, and they are of very, very high quality, very strong selection. And farmers seem to be happy, and it's increasing, this open pollinated consumption. It might not interfere or take over some of the hybrid markets, but all of these crops have their own areas, own growers, so they have their own niche, and they are producing reasonably good quantities in India. And we are one of the players that has a good some of the good products, and there are several other great companies out there who are also doing this. So thank you very much. This is my presentation. I guess the last slide was just it didn't show up, but I want to once again thank everyone. And this was my presentation on this. I mean, it's a lot of information. And also I want to thank my colleagues, Mr. Pradeep, Dr. Srishail, Mr. Sridhar Hegde, who really worked with me, and we shared a lot of ideas. And once again, thank you, Dr. Ayappan, for picking me, and Dr. Krishna Kumar. It was for us also a learning experience. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Arthur Santosh, for excellent presentation and giving a very detailed view of the vegetable industry, which forms the basis for nutrition security of the people. And you also highlighted excellent points on promoting indigenous vegetables. And we have to identify the potential ones area-wise, production-wise, and how to go about. And for everything, seed is the first. And unless seed is assured, both in terms of quality and quantity, nothing can be done further. And you also given what could be the quality seed, how to ensure production, and basic ecological requirement as well as technical requirement. And I think you have completed your lecture well within the time, with giving all the full details. On behalf of the organizers, I thank you very much. And if organizers permit for some question and answer, I don't know how it is. Dr. Ayappan, sir. Dr. Kumar, any questions?
We can elicit questions from persons, but you can also read, there is a comment in the chat box which says the problem of nutrition is not just ignorance of what to eat, but affordability and per capita income and more mouths, economic problems in a family in the poor section of the society. The vanishing traditional food is one of the reasons for going away from holistic approach of nutritious food consumption at affordable cost. Overeating greens can cause binding of iron by phytates and thus need to be careful. This is an important point. Overeating of greens can cause binding of iron by phytates and thus need to be careful. India is moving towards in the right direction. In moderation, but regularly eating is the message in small quantities of nutrition, but takes time to reach the national UN goal. Nutrition is slow process like vaccine. Dr. V. Prakash, President of the Nutrition Society of India.
Okay.
Thank you. Dr. V. Prakash, sir, is with us in the panel listed.
Welcome, Dr. Prakash, for
thank
the
thank you,
sir, as a nutrition expert, and also your interaction. And probably Dr. Shatavar has already briefed in his the importance of the native vegetables and how to promote them. And also the Nutri Garden at a family level, he has also indicated that how best the family nutrition can be ensured with the indigenous vegetables and other things. Dr. Santosh, you have added to any more information?
No, thank Dr. Prakash for that note that he's put. It's very important, and I will get in touch with him because we are also working in some of the village areas where we are trying to, you know, some sugarcane farmers are switching to vegetables. So we are also working with them. It's not a business as such, but we are working with them to make them understand the production part and let them choose what they want, because there are some growers in some parts of North Karnataka. So this is very good. I'm so glad that you put this note, and I'm happy that you used to know Dad. I will also connect with you separately.
Wonderful. The one point I have,
yes,
Kumar,
sir.
And Dandin and Arthur, yeah, is there are a lot of enthusiastic youngsters today in the urban systems who want to grow vegetables for their own consumption, maybe for the apartment consumption or so on. The real problem is there is no land. So the enthusiasm is curbed. And so, we talk about Ola, we talk about taxi and rental. So I think some of the corporates like you and who are very close to society and for the welfare of the society must look at rental places, like in Germany, when people go out on the weekend and grow. So this will be a fantastic community involvement in the wasted land, as Professor Swaminathan says, not wasteland, but wasted land. I think it's an important concept which can multiply the role that the youngsters, which you nicely mentioned, have the advantage of today having a mindset that has changed. They want to do something. They get the best seed from you, but are growing in probably a wrong soil for which it is not suited. There is very high load of gravel in that. So I think it's a public-private affair that need to be combined into using wasted land for the urbans to rent it out. Like, for example, I would like to take a 15 by 15 feet and try to grow. It is protected outside, so there are no goats, no cows, etc. So it kind of gives a happiness to touch a plant. Those of you who grow. So my second point is, there is a lot of emphasis that is needed today for good seeds in the spices, condiments, and herbs, and the Ayurveda area. Huge requirement. The whole country is lacking in fantastic seeds, but there are good research afterwards. What is good for one thing, what is not good for, but if the correct variety, for example, Tinospora cardiofolia, which is known as Amrutavalli, which is the correct seed that one has to use for doing it? Or it can be a graft also. So I think it's very important to see the value addition there. But excellent talk. I would like to say, in complimenting, the need of the hour is good seed to feed all. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Prakash. Thank you.
Dr. BNS Murthy.
Good afternoon to all of you. Thank you, Santosh, for a nice presentation, which touched upon many of the points that are very, very well articulated, and the requirement of the very good quality starting material, what Dandin was selling in the first question, whether the seed come first or the plant come first. It is a really challenging question, just like hens and chicken. But the thing is that quality seed is one of the best and foremost thing what we challenge, that about 15 to 20% of the productivity can go up. Similarly, when it comes to some of these new vegetables, biofortified vegetables, those are the ones which need to be focused right now. And as Dr. Prakash also told, spice sector is one that is very much neglected. Although some of the spices like chili and other things have been addressed very well, but some of the other spices which are in, we are in the commanding position in India, that needs to be taken up. When I was a horticulture commissioner, we promoted DASD, Directorate of Organic and Sweet Seed Spices. For production of quality planting material, we brought in some of these universities to produce the seeds and supply. Because otherwise, there is no private sector players in this area. This is one of the things that we can target. And coriander is one spice that you are targeting. That is another thing. And the Seed Act, which is 1966, is quite old, and a lot of discussions are going on to modify that one. The other thing is that the some of the portion that I wanted from information from you is, although you are not handling the planting material of many of these perennial horticulture crops, which is very, very important. But in vegetables or annual crops, if there is a problem, within a few, one cycle or two cycle, they can replace. In perennial crops, the quality and genuineness of the planting material is very important. For that, we have brought in National Nursery Portal, wherein all the nurserymen are going to be registered and it has to be sourced from there only. That kind of initiatives. And the supply of pollen, that is a very, very good concept, and we need to work on that one. Our institute is one of those first in that way of cryopreservation of pollen. Even for date palm pollen also, Dr. Krishna Kumar has initiated some of those work at the beginning itself with the help of Dr. Ganeshan. We had cryopreserved pollen. That is a very good concept, so that the policy of male parent is also one. Another one aspect, important aspect I want to touch upon, sir, for all, it is a matter for thinking. We are talking more about organic production, organic production, organic production. Whether we can sustain that one. In our country, we need to cater to many people. Although the total food, vegetable production 197 million tons divided by number of people 135 billion, it equates to the requirement of 400 grams per day. But whether we can sustain that one with organic production, we need to look for about the safe vegetable production, safe horticulture crop production. This is one area for thinking where there is no further residue levels. This is some of these viewpoints. It's only comments that I want to pass it on, not related to any of this. This is for the thinking area. Thank you, sir, for this opportunity. No,
thank you very much. Yeah, with regard to pollen, if you have anything, you can just write to me and, you know, we have no problem. I'll put you on to our supply chain head, Mr. Sridhar Hegde. He's really worked on it from scratch. Like, we were doing it many years ago, then we stopped doing it, and then again we are doing it. So we got into it now a few years ago, and we can definitely share any information on that with you.
Now, in that area, we can work together, sir, at the Indian Institute of Horticulture Research. Yeah. We have a well-equipped lab and also cryopreservation area that we can even give for higher basis or whatever that basis that is required. For long-term storage also, we can work on that aspect.
Okay, sure, sure. They will get in touch with you, Mr.
Okay, thank you,
sure.
Thank you.
Dr. Kaur, I have a couple of points.
Okay, sure.
Some of them are how the seed industry is harnessing the seeds, some with regard to as a urbanization and some of them things. Is it possible, like your father started a small unit in Lal Bagh and the start of the Indo-American, we should have it at least in 4 or 5 places a nutrition vegetable for round the year production at a very small scale, where the society at large can very easily visualize how the space, both in terms of horizontally and vertically, is effectively utilized for the year-round production. And in that regard, I think the private and public sector coming together through their KVKs or something, demonstrating in different blocks, would be, if Kudumbashree can be such a wonderful and successful program, there is every possibility of replicating it on a larger scale. At least in the peri-urban area, where partly some land is available, and also into villages where many of these things. With regard to the cryopreservation, my main apprehension is, today if we don't cryopreserve the pollen of the wild species, we may lose the wild species in the forever. I particularly feel that more than a genetic resource, we have to have the diversity that is associated. See, the pollen as a snapshot is a collection of diversity, whereas the seed is not so much. So that is something which has to be realized. My problem with seed production, whether it is in Ranebennur or any other places, most of the viruses are not seed transmitted. And in that regard, what happens is the seed from a virus affected plant and a healthy plant is mixed and sold, whether it is papaya, whether it is chili, or whether it is tomato. And in the process, we are continuously diluting the seed health and seed viability, at least in these kinds of crops. something that needs to be done very critically. For example, papaya you take. We easily mix the PRSV infected papaya fruit as well as the healthy fruit, and then the seed in bulk is sold. The same thing applies to chili, same thing applies to tomato and n number of crops, including cucurbits like pumpkin and many others. The other aspects which I would like the private sector to focus is, whether we like it or not, the 50% of the Indian population is going to become urban very shortly. Vertical expansion will become the order of the day. The area that is available in a balcony may be hardly 5 feet by 5 feet or 10 feet by 10 feet. But everybody would like to have their own coriander, their own mint, their own etc., without pesticide at least. Is it possible to develop and design a pro tray which can be kept in their balcony, which can address their small requirement of, let us say, curry leaf, coriander, palak, or whatever it is, so that even you can sell the trays with a mixture and people will bring those trays and keep it, and after some time you can take back the tray and replace it with something. The only thing is, in an apartment this should be much easier, where hundreds and thousands of houses are often the common practice. These are, I think, something we have to make the industry interfaced vertical space utilization in many of the apartments. Yeah. This is something that needs to, for example, one chili, one small coriander, one mint, a couple of curry leaves, maybe a little bit of greens, and a couple of flowering plants. Everybody is looking for it. We have not invested, in spite of the floriculture growing much faster than vegetables. The kind of investment or the has not really percolated to the common man. Most of them do not even know what to keep it in shade and what to keep it in sun. And half the time they lose their crop. I was also in Africa, where the entire Western Africa, do not even produce tomatoes, where 3 to 4 months or 5 months they go without tomatoes. Whereas so much of tomato is produced in Karnataka, Germans and many others are supplying ketchups to Nigeria and many others. For some reason, we are absolutely, with so much of knowledge, I was pleasantly surprised when the director of AVRDC, who is a rice breeder, told that we are going to teach the farmers of Karnataka how to increase the productivity of tomato. I wanted to give him back at that same time, with one scientist making huge claims on a world forum, whereas we are many a times with so much of knowledge we are not able to articulate and thereby earn the business. Somewhere there is a lack of public-private sector taking our scientific and industrial strength, especially to continents like Africa, which hold tremendous promise. Yeah. I feel that something seriously needs to be done. We have to become like Jews in marketing our many of these things so that we make an impact.
Yeah, it's, I mean, we can, coming to the first point, we now have a lot of growers, techies who've turned growers, and they're doing a brilliant job on hydroponics. And, you know, we'll talk to them and they can maybe do a show and tell program. Maybe we can start with Republic Day so that we have time to create something for people to see. And then also the apartment complexes, the terraces are fine. The balconies are okay as long as there's light. But now what I heard that Philips and GE are trying to bring in more grow lights so that you can, if you want to grow even a chili or some produce, you'll need the light, you know, with that 450, 750 nanometer, whatever those bandwidth, so that the, you know, photosynthesis is driven properly. So I believe right now the lights are very expensive. We were just speaking to someone last week, but there are people who are also growing under lights, and there are now even aeroponics. Apparently one innovator has come up with aeroponics where he's actually grown these vegetables and lettuce under a fine sterile mist conditions and light, and he says the growth rate is so fast the plant is much matures earlier also. So there are some of these people who work with our products, and some of them who are just our associates. So we'll let me work on it. I'll talk to Rashmi also, our joint managing director, and she's working with different growers. Like right now, some of them are growing hot peppers to be supplied into the market. They're growing on hydroponics. They're also growing in the farm. But these are non-agriculture people who've taken the passion for it, studied, and they are growing it. And that is, I think, very inspirational, as you said, if someone wants to come and see it. So we will we'll try to see if we can make something work. And you know, if not on a continuous basis, we can do a pilot, a proper pilot, where people, it should be, the you know, people should understand how this growing is going to happen. So we can work on that. Yeah, definitely.
Thank you.
Dr. Attawar, I have one specific and a very direct question.
Yeah.
We are well known that drumstick has been well accepted as a granary of nutrition all over the world. But when it comes to the production of seed and planting material, I have been putting this question for last 6 years. Nobody has taken into the venture. Tissue culture plant supply in tissue in drumstick, if it's there, because as you know, as a plant breeder, 40 to 45% of segregation is there, and what you get a seed out of open pollinated will not that.
Yeah.
Either you should grow in isolation and to produce a seed, but some amount of heterozygosity needs to be there. That's also is there. It's a linkage. If your tissue culture laboratory can develop a protocol for mass scale propagation of plus, it may be Bhagya variety, it may be PKM1, it may be PKM5, whatever it may be, that could help the people to have assured planting material. Otherwise, the segregated population we are sending seed has a problem. Kindly, this is a specific thing to be looked into. And what you have said, it is IPM. IPM and IDM, both integrated pest management, integrated disease management. It is more important because all the foliage of the vegetables are also nutritious, and naturally they attract the both pest and pathogens, right? So this has to be done with this. But as a part of the question or a suggestion of Dr. Krish Kumar, individual house terraces are open and there is no right is required. So a small structure tailor-made,
it's possible.
With a light potting material and also pots.
Yeah.
If things are developed,
we are promoting more of
10 pots of 10 varieties, they will make a day complete for a month together. These are the two things.
BNS Murthy would like to say something.
A long way to go to propagate this. Of course, urban horticulture is a terrace horticulture, to tell you frankly. Thank you.
Dr. BNS?
I want to add to that point. In fact, recently we got a RKVA project in our institute. We have to demonstrate at 25 different places. First point is to be, it will be inoculated within a month. And other 24 within the Bangalore, if some of the RWAs come forward, our institute is ready to go for a demonstration of terrace gardening. At the same time, all the technologies that is developed from our institute. And recently we have written a letter to Commissioner Bangalore, the BBMP also, so that they can give some space in majority of the parks where there's some space, so that we can put up our vegetable and fruit gardening area with silage culture. That is in the offing, sir. Within March, we are going to have about 25 such demonstration centers.
No, that's very good. We'll also probably meet with you on those two. One is the pollen, the cryogenic preservation, and then terrace gardening. But to answer Dr. Krishna Kumar's question, definitely it's possible. And there are some modules that we already have. So I'll share more information with you over email on these aspects, on balcony gardening. And that is even with basic light levels, we can still do it. And then the other ones are, of course, the like in a place like Lal Bagh, where we can do a small show and tell of how else to grow vegetables. And, you know, we can do that, leafy vegetables as well as regular vegetables.
There is a small chat box. Dr. Dandin, one nimsha. There is a small chat box. How about using seed or byproduct as edible coating? Somebody has asked from a, I didn't comprehend what it is. How about using seed or byproducts as edible coating? I'm not able to comprehend the question.
seed on.
How about using seeds slash byproducts as edible coating? From YouTube.
Yeah. See, right now, like, you know, a lot of the gourds, like pumpkin seeds, sunflower seeds, and, you know, watermelon seeds, they're all consumed. And sometimes we have a problem to import because they say it's edible, and it's not edible. We are actually getting planting material. So there is, there's a lot of it, but specifically, they are being used also as roasted and salted, as you all might have seen in many countries. But even they are making that into separate edible, you know, different edible products as well. So, but seed as such, I don't know, like a tomato, I have not heard of. But yes, all the many of the cucurbits are widely used for eating.
Seeds are highly rich in oxalates. One should be very careful.
Correct.
What to eat and what not to eat. Correct.
We have to like be scientifically, we have to study it and then consume it. Yeah, that's true.
Are there any questions from students or the, you know, lady scientists or from somebody? This is not a, this is a forum open to everybody. We request
a question. There is a question I would like to unmute the participants. They will introduce and they will ask the question directly. Dr. Yeah. I will unmute them now.
Can I, sir?
Yeah, please. Dr. Sudhama.
I would like to compliment Dr. Thawar on a wonderful presentation. It's more of a, I'm just wanted to supplement some of the things that were discussed. I have come across a lot of modules where urban, especially they come up with a small structure where they can plant, each person can decide what kind of vegetables they want to grow. They'll give the soil or the micronutrients and everything, and they'll show, demonstrate how to grow this on their terraces. This is already, many people are adopting this, and this is, it has been incubated in one of our incubators based in Hyderabad.
Okay.
And another thing is, we also have come up with, I think IIHR itself is selling these horti kits, where we have some seeds and also some manures and things which easily a person can take it, and we are already doing that. From IIHR, I have seen these things going on also. I also came across some modules, like people who are want to show, especially in the urban areas where many of our apartment complexes, people living in apartment complexes, they don't know where the, like milk, we always say, if you ask a child where the milk is coming from, he says from the milk booth. Similarly, if you ask them where the vegetables are coming from, he'll say that there's the neighborhood shop. So they have come up with a module where nearby places, Ramnagra or Kanakapura Road, they have actually interacted or linked with some of the farmers, and they have said, like, you can select what vegetables you want, and the farmer will grow it for you, and the whole family will go during the weekends, look at the plants and teach the children what the entire farming is, pluck there, buy the vegetables and come back. This kind of models are also there, but how successful or how continuously they are going on, I am not sure, but I have come across these models. And I think sky is the limit when it comes to greens and supplying, and a lot of modules are, especially people are working on this, and even using the artificial light, how to give it to the vertical gardening. That is also a lot of work is going on. It will be very good if someone like Indo-American hybrids could also have a collaboration with some of the ICR institutes or IIHR. I think we could do a lot more. Thank you so much.
Yes, thanks, madam. Yeah, we are doing, we also have some kits that we are distributing, and there's a good response for it. But, you know, the repeatability is very essential. And one of the two problems that we've encountered is the consistency of the planting material in terms of the coco peat, the quality of peat. It has to be, you know, well composted, and then that has to be always consistent. So that's why the suppliers of peat should have some ownership to supply good product. Secondly, it's with the light and then the nutrition. So now what we are doing is we are engaging with specialists in each field, because they also help us for seed production. And then we are tailoring it now, as you said, to do a, in fact, we will have a, soon we will have our own show and tell program where we are growing crops like this, so that anyone, a child or anyone, can come and take a look, students or anyone. And we are also working on it, and we are open to working with any institute, and we'll also learn, and we can also share our ideas. We are very open to that. We've always been open to that. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Dr. Surinder K. Tiku, sir, now you can speak and ask questions.
Speak? Can I speak?
Please.
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, Dr. Tiku.
Okay. This is Surinder Tiku. Good morning, and thank you very much, Santosh ji, for that very, you know, exhaustive information and to the point. I just had a few points to say, you know, because we now have a lot of improvement in both on the improvement side of new varieties and hybrids, and also the agronomic side, that, you know, the seed quality has improved. The seedling transplants has become a big business in India now.
Yes.
Unfortunately, not to as much in the north. I still find people struggling to get good seedlings, but in the south and west, I think a lot of seed transplant business has opened. But now the question is, there are a few things that I felt, you know, how do we take it? The yields of our average yields are still half of China and 1/4 of USA in almost every crop for the main, you know, cucurbits and tomatoes and peppers, etc. So how do we increase this average yield so that the total productivity can, because unless that productivity comes, how do we reach the 400 gram per day? How do we reach? So we need to first produce more. And then for that, we need to have a system on how do we take it to the 80% farmers who are 1.5 acres, but their knowledge of agronomy and their access to seeds is very limited. So this is my first comment. The second part is, this will further increase the glut situation, especially in the Rabi. You know, we have already seen in Karnataka in March. I mean, I have been hearing it for last 20 years. In February, March, they don't have enough to even harvest. They throw it on the roads and the trucks go over the tomatoes. So we haven't still developed an ecosystem of a good processing industry that can take that extra production. So second point is that we need to strengthen our processing so that this extra production can be handled, because it will happen, extra will happen in the Rabi season. Other times, I think, because now we need to produce seeds throughout the year, so we need to have varieties that can grow, you know, different segments of varieties for different varieties for different, you know, seasonal segments in each crop, already happening in many crops, but we need to increase it. And lastly, I think Dr. Prakash very rightly mentioned about the need of these, the incomes, you know. So how do we develop an action plan on these three areas? You know, how does that income increase so that they can buy the vegetables that are needed? Because consumers are not, they still want cheap vegetables, you know. There are lots of things that I feel need a brainstorming. It may not happen in this lecture. And lastly, there was a question about that, this terrace gardening. I have a friend who was a breeder till about 2 years back. He has opened a company called Urban Kisan. It's a hydroponic company in Hyderabad. They sell for 10,000 rupees or 12,000 rupees and a small equipment that can grow hydroponics in 6 feet by 4 feet. And I have seen it practically happening. And he has opened now 5 even fresh market stores where people come there and buy the high quality, because it is not organic, but it is, sustainable, healthy production. They pay almost double than what they pay out in the mandis. So these are a few comments I wanted to make. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Dr. Tiku. I mean, really quick, I'll just, respond to that. One of the aspects is I've been discussing with some scientists like you about how to, you know, promote more of zoning, wherein specific agroclimatic zones are dedicated to certain crops. And that way, at least the certain control mechanism may happen, because this glut is an issue, as you said, in Karnataka very constantly and also sometimes around Nasik belt it happens. So some sort of a zoning of tomato only areas and the seasons. But more importantly, the next point, which links up with what Dr. Krishna Kumar said, I've traveled in some of the countries in West Africa, and a lot of ketchup is coming in. I think it's being branded by the Italians, but it's being produced in China. And I think if we can get more, as you said, more of the processing, which is less than 5% today of all the produce, agro processing, I feel that's a big, that is where the government should interact, you know, for example, with the, you know, KSTA and with the scientists like you and with companies, and try to push us on the global market. And definitely, if they give us a little bit of support and a conducive policy and support, we can do it, because they are all coming from China, and India can at least produce the high quality ketchup varieties. There are many great varieties with the good pulp to paste ratio and all. But this has to be studied, as you said, it needs a deeper discussion.
Yeah.
And with regard to that kit that you were mentioning, we would be very interested to connect. I will separately contact you for that.
Yeah,
we have a lot of inquiries, and this would be a great thing, because definitely there is a lot of traction on urban farming, urban flower production, everything in the house, and there's a lot of time. And with the way things are progressing with the pandemic, I don't see anything really taking off for another year at least, minimum. And people are going to be at home. They're going to want to innovate. They want to learn to grow. So the right starting material is the best. The seed, the material, the lights, or the media, and everything. So that's very critical. Because sometimes there are a lot of fly-by-night operators who try to ride the wave and encash. And that has to, those kind of players have to slowly, you know, go away or be made to go away by increasing more awareness amongst buyers.
Thank you very much, sir. Dr. Surinder, sir, hope your questions answered.
Thank you. I know that Dr. Sairam Reddy has been identified as the top 10 in the Forbes list of young startups. Okay. It's a very, very interesting startup.
I think I saw an article by him. I will contact you. That's very interesting.
Yeah,
very, very interesting.
I will let you know.
Sure, Dr. Tiku. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now I would like to unmute Dr. Dilip Masuthi, who would like to ask one more question. Yes, sir. Please go ahead, sir.
Sir, namaste, sir. Good afternoon.
Yeah, good afternoon.
Sir, I was seeing your presentation. It was good, sir. And I have a query. So there are lot much things done with the quality in foreign countries. In our country, there are less. Maybe some public sector, maybe Incotech in Ahmedabad, and TNU. They are doing some work with the quality enhancement, or maybe designing, maybe enhancement techniques. But I could not see the same work with Indo-American. Are there any works or progress with respect to the horticulture crops in Indo-American?
Yeah. So we basically stick to our core competency of seed and seed quality. So what we do is we work with a couple of companies in India. There's who make good seed treatments. We work with them, but our quality lab does the evaluation of the efficacy and the seed quality. Like even with Incotech, they have some good treatments. We work with them, so we are doing that. And we are going to start doing our own treatment soon, but of course the raw material will come from experts in the area, but we can have the treatment machines and equipment that we are planning to invest maybe in the next 12 months, 24 months, so that we have a very good finish on the product. See, a lot of emphasis is being paid on the, you know, look and feel of the product as well. The customer, when they see it, you know, so along with that look and feel, also placement of trace minerals, fertilizers and all is happening. So we work on the application side, but the development side are done by maybe experts like TNAU, Incotech, and there are some smaller companies as well who do some very good treatments of different types of treatments, whom we work with. Then we apply it, we check it, we send it to the farmers, and then the distributors, if they like it, if the grower likes it, then we bring that into the mainstream. So we do it in that way. because we feel we'll be spreading ourselves thin if we try to do everything. So we let the experts do it, and then we use the applications in our on our seat. Yeah. And I mean, you can always email me and I can share more information on some of the other companies that are having some good treatments, Indian companies.
Definitely. I am too working with those things, sir. I'll be in touch with, sir.
Sure. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thanks. Thank you very much, sir. Now over to Dr. Bandim, sir. Sir, please.
Thank you, Dr. Attawar, for having
Dr. Dandin.
Yeah, please. Now you unmute, Dr. Kumar, unmute. Dr. Kumar, please unmute.
There are two more questions in the chat box.
Please.
If you want, I'll read or you can read.
I can read.
Okay. Sir, many officials, directors, and scientists from ICR have joined the session. If anybody has got any of the directors or scientists from ICR, you are open. The question that they have asked is, how about scope of dried vegetable market? And also, it is also a means of preventing post-harvest loss. So we know many times the freeze-dried vegetables or many of the things are exported, something like okra and many others. That particular question, I think probably also holds a scope if you want to. We are now looking into dehydrated mushrooms and dehydrated XYZ. And I think that is something which probably in a very briefly, if you can just reply, Dr. Attawar.
Yeah, the dried vegetables as such, mainly we do some work with peas, and we don't do the drying or the freezing. With the freezing they do, but drying of vegetables is a very good idea for those that can be dried and used, like maybe some bitter gourd and some of the vegetables. But we'll have to see the feasibility of drying them, and then the return to the grower on them, or if someone can buy it and then add value by drying it, provided it's got a good drying capacity, that can be studied. But we right now are not doing much with these. But we know there are companies who have done, for example, tomato drying for export to Italy, and there are companies doing it. But yes, more of it will help to bring down the post-harvest losses. But there are many vegetables that cannot be dried, and some of the, for example, rainy season vegetables, they're very difficult to even dry it. And then the equipment required, that is also very important for desiccation and for the drying, like dehydrators and stuff. But we've done a lot of experiments with hot peppers from different parts of the world to see the color quality, to see the, the pungency is already there, but the color quality. And right now we are working with one of the pizza chains from the US that's operating in India. So they wanted us to develop some peppers for them, open pollinated lines, for that purpose. So that in hot pepper, as there are more and more possibilities with this, which is already being done, but there are more possibilities. But in other vegetables, we haven't seen much happening, but it's a very good idea because it's happening in a large scale in Japan, Korea, China, where even the soups, they have a lot of dehydrated vegetables, soups and noodles, and then they seem to be working very fine with carrots.
Somebody close to Hubli Airport was doing, I know, a couple of years back. I don't know whether it is still there or not. They dice it and then process it in a particular way and doing it. So the purpose of raising some of these is to, we have science, we have technology, but as a group, we do not know how to translate the technology into commerce and money.
Correct.
I think that is where all of us have to put our heads together to translate that kind of a technology into money.
Processing, I feel, is the way forward. Even for drying comes under the processed foods, we are very negligent percentage, and that has the sky is the limit, and potential vegetables, and the thing is, once we get the technology, then the scalability on the commercial side is very important. So for example, dried carrots and peas and onions in a soup, a vegetable soup. Now, how scalable is the model, and what's the commercials, and is it profitable for the person doing it? for the person buying it and for the person growing it. So it's a little tricky, but I'm sure if other countries are doing it, we can study those models. We should not hesitate to study models that are already, you know, established in other countries and then innovate something for the Indian requirement. I mean, that's my point of view.
Do you have any ideas to touch upon mushrooms at this stage?
No, it's a tempting thing, but we don't want to get in there because already we got enough vegetables. So
okay.
Mushrooms has always been interesting.
Okay. I am just floating the idea. Dr. Sunil Archak would like to say something in continuation of his previous talk.
Okay, sure, sure.
Sunil?
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. In this past 1.5 years or 2 years, NBPJ has been organizing
an offer.
Yeah, hello. Yeah. Am I audible now?
Yes.
Yeah.
In the past 1.5 or 2 years of this lockdown kind of thing or a COVID period, NBPJ has been organizing a number of webinars. And our experience is after every webinar, and because webinars reach a number of people, large and wide, every time after webinar, people contact us for seeds. So the points which Dr. Santosh made are very valid. Each one of them is very valid, and there is no debate on that. The point, like Dr. Krishna Kumar has said, is how do we, how do all of us, all the expertise can come together and then make this, let's say we are keeping this as a street question. How do we popularize? How do we address nutritional insecurity and all things? So we have answers to all these things, but we are not able to, let's say, implement them in one or the other way. I just want to make two points, quick points. Many other points are there with which I'll take up directly with Dr. Santosh. First point is, when he was speaking about underutilized vegetables, some of the underutilized or local vegetables, I saw that there was passion in his voice. So he was pretty liking the way he was saying that. Underutilized. Hello? Okay. So he was talking about underutilized vegetables. So there are a number of them. There are a number of underutilized vegetables in our northeast, in our western ghats, and then NBPJ has been working on some of them. And then we are trying to prepare a number of these brochures and trying to popularize them. But this is a very insufficient exercise. We are aware of that. But this is still at a stage where it is collect and then market. People collect from wild and they're not growing it. They're not cultivating them. They're just collecting and then marketing. So what is required now, if you want to, let us say, diversify your shelves in the market, what is required now is to see that there is a contribution in terms of agronomy. There is a contribution in terms of quality seeds, which you have already touched upon, production of seeds. And there is a contribution in terms of advertising, popularizing that particular product, and for which we require support. However, one very, very important point which is required is, every time you popularize or advertise some new product in different forms, what is required is a scientific veracity of what we are claiming. So what happens is we know by practice or by our let's say by forefathers, and then we know that these vegetables are very important, these fruits are very important, we know these things. But some scientific studies have to be commissioned, however small they are, some scientific studies have to be commissioned, and based on some those scientific studies, you just put some claims saying that, look, this is very good for this post-COVID recovery. This is very good for this vitamin requirement for the students who are studying inside since last 2 years. So some kind of these things are very, very essential. So this is first point. That means end-to-end, which you mentioned already. Some other company cannot do this because you people are already in the business of the seed production. So like we have in downtown New York, there is a shop. You go there, you want to have dosa, you can eat dosa. You want to have a liquid batter, you buy liquid batter. You want to have a powder, you can buy a powder. You want to buy a recipe, you buy a recipe. So it's like this. So the provision of giving choice to the consumers is the topmost thing. Rest all will take care by itself. Everybody knows. Nobody is contesting the importance of vegetables or the nutrition or anything. But the only challenge is about the availability of choice. So if I go to a supermarket or any other vegetable shop, what has changed over the last 30 years? Not much has changed. A lot of technologies have changed in the production, in seed production, in crop production, in the various introduction of new vegetables or new crops. But nothing much has changed what we see in the shelves. So that has to change. if you want to attract new age consumers, young people, techies or other people who have less time, so what is your process of giving, let's say, sliced, diced vegetable ready to eat, which also includes local vegetables kind of thing. So this part has to be taken care of. And next small point is about, everybody is talking about the terrace farming, balcony farming, etc. Please don't forget about other areas beyond the urban areas. And CSR activities of Indo-American can look forward to work with schools for this. It's very, very important. Okay, now one point which perhaps many people have missed because MBPGR works with that directly.
Volume increase, Madi Archak.
Hello.
Yeah.
Okay, sorry. Is about what is happening internationally with respect to regulation of seed production. Regulation, regulatory apparatus internationally. What people are doing internationally. For example, in a recent most meeting of Commission on Genetic Resources for Food and Agriculture, CGRFA, okay. There was one point Dr. Santosh showed a pie chart of organized sector, private, public, etc. Although we had a different figure in that one, but people are interested globally, what is happening in India, who is producing how much amount of seeds for whatever reason. So you can see, you can read between the lines what they want to know, who is commissioning those studies in these United Nations platforms, who is commissioning from Europe and other places, and what they want to capture in India. So everybody must understand this. If we are still discussing and brainstorming, somebody else is occupying and capturing your market. Please remember this.
Correct.
This is very essential. We are still discussing. People are already preparing their action plan for capturing our market. People are commissioning studies for profiling the vegetable consumption and profiling the nutritional aspect of the human beings in different parts of the country. So people are doing this. So we should be quick in whatever we are deciding. And without joining hands between public and private sectors, this will not be done. Simple. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Sam.
That last one is a critical point.
Yeah. We have to work together and we have to work fast. So that we act on our own products and our own native plants, and then we have to see the scalability, and then the awareness will come. Otherwise, when somebody else does it, and then we try to play catch up, which is not possible.
Dr. Attawar, when you submit the your writings, some of the points that emanated from the discussion in this, if you could also be incorporated in your submission, I think some of these points will also come as a policy interventions.
Yeah.
Because KSTA would also like to have those kinds of policy interventions. And whatever we do, you know, that will have a would be replicated easily in many other aspects. So I would especially like the points that he was telling, as you said, the last couple of points by Sunil Archak and some of the points in the Western Africa not able to do. If Karnataka can have its own agricultural attaché who can negotiate with these countries for the supply of tomato, ketchup or puree, many of these things will, you know, a small opening is required and others will build upon it. So some
please reflect. Being a state subject, why not start with the state, and state can become a model for other states, you know, that because
probably we will request to Dr. Ayyappan.
State subject.
Yeah.
So yeah.
We'll probably request the KSTA to facilitate a meeting of all the speakers in this at the time of the symposium or after the symposium, so that they can help the government as to come out with those kinds of policies.
Okay.
Nudge for the benefit of the state, and let us see how it can go further. Dr. Dandin?
Yeah, please.
Thank you.
So, to sum up the discussions, this is only the speech of Dr. Attawar on seed and planting material. In addition to that, a lot of interactions,
yes.
Lot of questions, and all those things we have been able to get from the audience. Probably till November 10th and 11th, 12th, till we complete our this one, these are all going to add up to our own knowledge, and we'll all compile them. And yes. Later, probably when we compile, when the policy paper is ready, which will be circulated and updated. Then we can call a, as Dr. Atta was telling, the state departments. These are more important. They are the people who are driving the vehicle of this progress and productivity. We should look into those things also. But nevertheless, what are the points you have emanated will be including in our discussion part, as well as what can be taken as a policy issue. And on behalf of the organizers, I thank Dr. Tawar, and this story is going to be till last next 4 months, September, October, November, next 3 months. So till then, we will have an opportunity to gather a lot of inputs from the point of view of seed, agronomy, post-harvest, especially post-harvest sector. Many people have asked, we are very, very, I don't want to say poor, but we are lagging behind compared to many of the other countries because we produce and we waste. This is what is the slogan we have. So probably the processing industry is geared up in line with the production industry. Probably this question can be solved. And many of the issues which are post-harvest technology people, and we have plotted quite a good number of people presenting the papers in our conference on 10th, 11th and 12th of November. Probably these issues will come up. With this, I thank Dr. Atawar and all the participants, and I will hand over the mic to KST organizers to conclude the session. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, sir. We have listened to a very scholarly and insightful distinguished talk on role of vegetable seeds and planting material in health and nutrition security by very successful entrepreneur and chairman and managing director of Indo-American Hybrid Seeds, Dr. Santosh Atawar. On behalf of KSTA, Vigyan Prasar, University of Agricultural Sciences, ICR, IHR, and all the participants, I thank Dr. Santosh Atawar for this wonderful talk. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
I take this opportunity to thank session chair, Dr. SB Dandin, sir, for chairing this session so well. In fact, we had a very long discussion period, more than 1 hour. We had question and answer. This is the most successful talk, I should say. Thank you very much, sir, for conducting this meeting so well. Very grateful to you. I am very thankful to distinguished experts, Dr. K. Krishnakumar, sir, who has been helping us in organizing this program, and also Professor Dandin, Professor Indresh, and Dr. BNS Murthy in planning this program so well and charting out the lecture series and helping us and guiding us in implementing this very popular program. On behalf of KSTA and all the associating organizations, we would like to thank you immensely, sir, Dr. Krishnakumar, Dr. Dandin, Dr. Indresh, and Dr. BNS Murthy. Thank you very much, sir. I am also very grateful to our esteemed member of KSTA, Dr. Ambekar Eknath, former director in ICR, for joining us in this webinar. I am thankful to Dr. Bharat Bhushan, senior scientist, Vigyan Prasar, Government of India, for joining us in this webinar. Thanks, doctor. I am also thankful to KSTA Lifetime Achievement Awardee and former director of CFTRI, Dr. V. Prakash, sir, for joining this webinar. Thank you, sir. My special thanks to renowned horticultural experts, Dr. Jose Romano Ferrero, Dr. Sunil Achak, and Dr. Sudha Mysore for joining the webinar. Thank you very much. I'm also thankful to principal scientist of NIO, Dr. Bille Damodar Shenoy, who had joined this meet, and also Dr. P.L. Patil and all the eminent scientists and senior academicians who have joined this webinar. Thank you very much, sirs and madam. I wish to thank all the participants who have joined both on Cisco WebEx and YouTube platform. Thank you. We'll be having one more distinguished talk on next September 20th. We'll be sending you the invite. Please do join and encourage us. I take this opportunity to wish you all a very happy Varamahalakshmi festival. Thank you very much. Be safe. Take care. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank Dr. Ayyappan. And the next September 20th will be from Dr. Sudha Mysore. And that will be on commercialization of fruit and vegetable technologies and their implications to health and nutrition. So She is heading the Agro Innovate as a CEO in ICR. So a number of technologies across the spectrum of the country will be discussed, and it will be a nice discussion. We profusely thank Dr. Ayyappan, the chairman KSTA, for making this whole process, and also Umesh also for this facilitation of this meeting. Dr. Akhtawar, it was a wonderful presentation. Wholeheartedly thank you for this.
Thank you very much, everyone. Thank you. Thank you.
I take this opportunity to thank our Honorable Chairman, Professor S. Ayyappan, under whose initiative this program has been planned. In fact, he was there till 5 minutes back, since he had some work, he had to leave early. On behalf of all of you, I would like to thank him immensely. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Dr. Bharat, thank you.
Namaskara, Umesh.
Sir, Krishna Kumar, sir, thank you.
Chanagito. Yellargo Kalispitra, letter la.
Just a minute, sir. 2 minutes.